That's what they always say.
You better pay premium.
I'm gonna start shelling it out, I'm gonna get some rain.
You better pay the women's membership.
Did I know get rain? To hear that, I'd have got rain, so I, we stuck in there, I'm gonna live. What happened to me? Oh, good to see all of you, good to see you, number 81. Hard to believe you've been coming 81 Wednesdays. Been coming more than that, ain't you? We've just been doing a lesson for 81 of them, week 81, chapter 19. We'll go ahead and get started with some prayer requests. I guess the majority of you know about John Jenkins and Millie and their youngest son passed away. He went missing on Friday and they had found him deceased. So if you would, just continue to pray for that family. That's just such a terrible shock. Don't know what happened, but just pray for John and Millie. I guess that's the last son of the two boys. Just remember them in your prayers if you would. So continue to remember Danny Hewitt. That's Renee Davidson's brother-in-law, her sister Dana. Didn't get to visit with him in the ICU the other day. They actually let me into the hospital and actually had prayer with him, and he's saved, he's ready to go. But let's just continue to pray for the Hewitt family, if you would. Is this thing working? I can't tell. I put a new battery in it. Does that sound like that? Well, I have to start over. But anyway, just continue to remember the Hewitt family and prayers and them. And the Robertson gentleman that we talked about Sunday to pray for, his name is Rex. So continue to pray for Rex Robertson. That God will just be with that family and help them through this ordeal they're in there. You got a request for uplifted hand? Maybe somebody you'd like to mention?
My sister, Opal, she just got it. She spent several days in the hospital again, and she's got, they said it was like double pneumonia. Her lungs are in bad shape, and she's got to have something cut out. I don't really understand it, but she can't get an appointment until July to get that procedure done, and she's really sick. She needs a miracle.
All right, let's pray for Opal. God will just touch her, heal her. Remember Dennis Wright, friend of mine, Dennis. He's in the hospital with pneumonia as well. Saw that on Facebook, so let's pray for Dennis tonight. I think they would keep him as a precaution, just a monitor. But pray for Dennis tonight. Somebody else you want to mention?
Remember Roy in prayer.
How is Roy?
He was not swollen quite as bad Monday, but he's still real swollen, so he's still not doing very good.
All right. Did you pray for him? All right, let's go to God in prayer. Hold on. Gracious Heavenly Father and Almighty God, we come to you tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus. First of all, thanking you for allowing us to be here tonight. As you've heard, we call out in prayer in the name of these who need your touch. You need a miracle touch from you. But we know you're in a great position. We know you can do all things, and nothing is beyond your power. So we just pray for them tonight. We lift them up to you and asking you just to touch and to heal and to nurture and to minister and all that which they need. You can do so much more for them than we can, but it's our duty as our brothers and sisters to pray for them. Thank you for these who are here. And now, Lord, as we endeavor into this Bible study this evening, I pray that you open it up to us just as you gave it to John, that you would give it to us the same way here tonight. And we'll give you the thanks and praise for all of it. In your wonderful name, Jesus, we ask it by faith, and the saints would say, we love you, Lord. Amen. And amen. Pray for Brother John Aper, too. I talked to Brother John today. He said he was having some difficulty, of course, with his stomach. But he might be here, he said, so apparently he's not. So let's just pray for him and Janet that everything works out okay for them. All right, Revelation 19, 11 through 16. Flying through this chapter. Four verses at the time. We're eating her up. But no, we'll be moving along. We'll move quicker in these last chapters than we did leading up to these chapters. because all the learning phase of it, everything to know what's going on and how it works out, is given in the first chapters. Actually, from chapter 4 up to chapter 18, a lot of detail in those chapters. So now we're just, if you want to say, cruising into the millennial period. So there'll be a little bit of theology that we'll run across. But for the most part, we're just gonna see how it winds down after the tribulation and leads into the millennial. So on your notes, it said this passage is the most powerful passage in this chapter. Now that's my opinion, of course. Because the Lord Jesus himself now is seen leaving heaven with an army of saints following. And he's on a final mission to restore everlasting peace and to eradicate sin from this earth. That's the point of the second coming. People often get the rapture and the second coming mixed up. We sometimes take the rapture and we say it's the second coming, but it's really not. The rapture is before the second coming. And he doesn't come to earth during the rapture. He just comes in the clouds and calls the church out. And we go to him instead of him coming to us. But after the tribulation, what we're studying here now, he actually comes. We're going to see that. He actually comes to us. So let's look at our verses here tonight, and we'll see what we're getting into. Verse 11, John said, "Now I see heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is Call the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written." And here's what it is: King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Don't that make you feel good? King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's the man. Father, thank you. Thank you for these. Thank you for these scriptures. Now, as we endeavor to look into them and to learn that which we need to learn, I just pray that, Father, as we study here, we become better disciples, that we might be better evangelists. Those who join us on Facebook and those who may pull it up on YouTube or watch later, anyone that listens to this word, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you touch their hearts and open it up to them as well so they can be evangelists just as we are to lead a world to Jesus. So we give you the thanks and the praise and the glory for it. In your wonderful name we say it all. Amen and amen. All right, let's go through these verses. First of all, we'll look at 11 through 13. And then we'll talk about that. And the second page I gave you there is your scripture references. I did that so that you don't have to, you can make a note of them, but I did that so you don't have to turn over there and find all of them. If I do two or three in a row, I'll do that for you. But anyway, in verses 11 through 13, let's go back and read those. "I saw heaven open and a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. And he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God." Ooh. You know, when Christ first came to earth, his first entry to earth was to secure peace between God and mankind. He came to reconcile. That's why you've often heard it said that religion is man reaching out to God. But Christianity is God reaching out to man. So when he came the first time, it was to secure peace between God and mankind. And of course, that was done through the cross. Now, this entrance, his second entrance, will be to bring division between mankind and God. Because he's undone those who have accepted him and been born again and have pledged their lives to him. They're there with him. They're with him where he is. Those who are left are against him, and he is against them. That's the hard part for us to understand about a merciful God, but it's a true part. If he's not a God of judgment, then he couldn't be a God of mercy. There has to be a judgment there in order for him to show the mercy, and there is a judgment. And it's been happening throughout the whole book. And now he's coming to bring it to a final end. And that final end will be the division, which just simply means he is against those now who have rejected him. Now, in the triumphal entry, you remember that? When Christ came into Jerusalem, we celebrate that on Palm Sunday, his triumphal entry. Do you remember how he entered Jerusalem that day? On a donkey. Yeah, on a donkey, on the foal of a donkey. On a donkey that hadn't been ridden. That's the whole thing there. That they put their robes on and he could ride on that donkey. Now, the way he entered Jerusalem was an animal that kings who were coming into that place to rule. They had already won it in battle, or had already submitted unto it, or however it was. But when a king came in on that donkey, it was a sign of peace that he wasn't coming to war with them, but he was coming to rule over them. He was coming to reign over them. That's why the Jews thought that was the very time that Christ was going to set up his kingdom. Remember that? Remember James and John and their mom went to him and said, "When you come into your kingdom, put one boy on the right, one boy on the left." They thought that this triumphal entry was going to be the entrance of Christ setting up what we're going to study as a millennial kingdom. They thought it was going to be right then because they believed in him as the Messiah. And they knew the Messiah was going to do that. And they thought that was going to be the time. So when you come in on that donkey, if you remember, they were saying, "Hosanna," and "Save us." That's what that means, save us. But it wasn't going to happen at that time. So that portrayed a peaceful entry into Jerusalem as the king coming to rule. Now, this time, the white horse, this white stallion, it's a stallion, the white horse is also a king's animal, but it is an animal of war. That's what they rode into battle. That was the war horses. I read a while back, it's been a long time back, pre-COVID, I still remember, but I read a while back that those horses that they used in those battles, in Rome and all those legions and all those that used these horses into battle, I read where those horses, when they were reared, they were raised within that environment and trained. They were trained as to what they would do. That when the horses got to the battle, they said, and this is what they said in the article, that the horses could smell that. And they would get excited. And that's why they call them chargers. It's because the horse was excited to get into that battle. Can you imagine that? I mean, because that's what they were trained to do, and they were raring to go. And I thought that was real interesting when I read that. But this white horse, which is also an animal of war, is the horses that they rode into battle. So when you look at those two entrances of Christ, first he came to reconcile us unto God. It was in a peaceful sense. Now, humanity has rejected him, the final rejection, in those last 7 years, and now he's no longer coming to reconcile. He's drawn the line, Now he's coming as the warrior king. So, and this is not going to be a win or lose battle. He's already won it. But it's the fact that he's coming to put his seal of victory on those that are left. And he is called faithful and true. Yeah? Because he is the embodiment. E-M-B-O-D-I-M-E-N-T. He is the embodiment of faith and truth. He's not just faithful and true. He is faith and truth. That's who he really is. He created it, didn't he? You know, man didn't know faith until God gave us faith. He created what truth was and what faith is because he's the embodiment of that. And his judgment is true and faithful unto the Father, of course, because it's his will that he does. And his judgments are righteous. They're right. He does. He's doing the right thing. Whether we agree with it or not, it's the right thing. That's what the judgment of righteousness is. Now he judges, you know, he judges men's souls, doesn't he? Because it says his eyes are fire, or like a flame of fire. We've seen that before in Revelation. Where do we see that at first sight? Remember? John said his eyes were like a flame of fire. Yeah. He was walking around amongst the seven candlesticks. Remember that? Over in chapter 1. He was walking around. I think it's chapter 1, maybe going into 2. But he had his eyes were like a flame of fire. And what does fire do?
Purifies.
Well, it burns up, puts off heat. Fire penetrates. It burns out the chaff. And if it's not fireproof, it's going to burn up when the fire hits it. His eyes pierce into the souls of men. So when he makes that judgment, he's rightly judging them for the sin that they have. We're not able to do that. We go by actions. We go by what people do or what people say or how they behave or how they act or how they live. Or you know, we base our judgment of someone being a sinner on outward appearances. That's how we do it. Sometimes we might be wrong. We don't really know. But that's all we've got to go by. But Christ doesn't judge by the outward appearance. He looks into the soul of that person. And these people he knows have rejected him. These people are against him. He sees that. It's not that they can put on a show for him. He knows they're against him. You know, he told the Pharisees in quote the Old Testament, he said, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And so when he makes a righteous judgment, it's because he knows that they have rejected him and they're against him. Now, many crowns that were on his head, said on his head were many crowns or diadems. What do you think that means? What do you think it means to have many crowns? You know, I saw the queen the other day on TV. She's got one big old crown. I forgot how much they said that rascal weighed. 20-some pounds. But it took two men. And then they carried it for her. She didn't wear it. I don't wear it. But anyway, this is many crowns. What do you think that means?
Much power.
What?
Much power? Kings.
Many kingdoms, rule over many kingdoms. Much power, both things, exactly right. Many crowns means he's over many nations, isn't it? If you look at a crown, it represents each nation. And it means it's the full authority, as Marie said. The many crowns is full authority. It demonstrates or it denotes total rule. That's what it means. They understood that. The Jews understood that was total rule. And he said that there was a name written. He had not a theological, because I don't know what it is. I know that it disappoints you, but I don't know that. But I don't know what it is. There's no one that knows what it is, but he does. Now, as to whether that will be revealed to us at some point in eternity, I don't know. Doesn't really matter. I just want to be there. Whether I know that name or not, doesn't matter. I know the one name I need to know, and that name's Jesus. That's the name he needs for me to know, and I know that part. But wonder why he's the only one that would know that name. I mean, I'm just curious. I'm just asking if there was a name written that no one knew except himself. He's the only one that knows that one name. Wonder why. Did you ever think about any ideas of why that might be? I'm just trying to get your opinion. You know, but
maybe it's just to let us know we're just not going to know everything.
Good. I like that, Marie. Y'all hear what she said? Just let us know we don't know everything. And that's true. And that's true. And there's a reason we don't need to know everything, you know. There's a lot of things, you know, when Brother Sonny Hunmaker was coming, he still laughs. I talked to him just last week. But anyway, he still laughs about the fact he was sitting in the office. And I told him, I said, we don't know what we don't know. And I know that sounds like a double statement, see, just to say it. But there are things we don't know we don't know. I mean, seriously. This is one thing we know we don't know. We know we don't know what that name is. But if there was a purpose in knowing it, we would know what it is. But the fact that it's not revealed to us, as Marie has said, it's a God thing. It's a God thing. And that's where his sovereign rule comes into play. And that's where our trust comes into play. And that's why we believe in him as the sovereign Lord. Now, the robe that he was wearing, 13, he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood. And that word dip, it's translated dip. It makes you think that something has been tie-dyed. But the word is actually trying to get across here that there's blood on the robe. That's what it's trying to get across. He was clothed with a robe which had blood on it, or dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. Now, that name we're given. Well, let's talk about the robe just a few minutes. This is not new language to them. Turn to your second page. I almost said turn to your Bible. Up there under your references, under 11 through 13, we got the verses here from Isaiah chapter 63, verses 1 through 6. Now, talking about this robe, let's read what the prophet Isaiah had to say in regards to it. Who is this who comes from Edom with dyed garments from Basra? This one who is glorious in his apparel, capital H, traveling in the greatness of his strength. Who is this one? I who speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Who do you think that is?
Jesus.
It's the Lord. Yeah. Why is your apparel red? Isaiah asked. And your garments like one who treads in the winepress. And the answer is, I have trodden the winepress by myself, alone. I've trodden it alone. And from the peoples, no one from the peoples, no one was with me. That's not just the Jews. That's all of the nationalities. No one was with me, for I have trodden them in my anger and trampled them in my fury. Their blood is sprinkled upon my garments. That's why it's red. And I have stained all my robes, for the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed has come. Yeah. See? Church has been saved, born again are saved, but those who reject her are being punished. I looked, but there was no one to help, and I wondered that there was no one to uphold. Therefore, my own arm brought salvation for me. Yeah, there was nobody else that could save us for God except God himself. So he said, I looked and there's no one else that could really save anybody. So I did it. I did it. My own arm brought salvation for me. And my own fury, it sustained me. I have trodden down the peoples in my anger. I have made them drunk in my fury, and I brought down their strength to the earth. Anybody ever trampled in a wine press? Anybody ever made wine and sold on grapes? Have you ever seen them do it?
Yes, on TV.
Seen on TV? Well, that works for me. Well, what do they do? When they're stomping them grapes, they make it a mess, ain't they? And I mean, they are stomping fierce. They're trying to get every bit of juice out of that grape. They're not just walking around on it delicate. They're stomping in grapes with fury. Well, what's that causing every time they...
Juice.
Flies everywhere. It's all over. Now you get the picture of what John saw about the blood on the road. He came and shed his own blood that sinners might be saved by shedding his blood. Now, these people have rejected that. They've rejected his blood of salvation. Now he's stomping the blood out of them, and it's all splattered on his garment. And I know that sounds grotesque, but that's what judgment looks like. It wasn't pretty on that cross, and neither is his judgment upon the final mankind. So he stomps it to get it done. And that's the picture John is trying to get across, is a furious God stomping at it, and the blood going everywhere, and the juice of the grapes flying everywhere. That's the picture he's trying to get us to see. And then, after he said that, or after he saw that, he said, and his name is called the Word of God. Go back to your sheet there. You're probably still on that under your references. John, this is the same John that wrote the gospel. It's the same John that's put the words in Revelation. And in his gospel, in the first chapter, in verse 14, he put these words down. And the Word, the capital W, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So there's no question this is Christ, being called the Word of God. And it goes back to just what we said about the embodiment of faith and truth. He is also the embodiment of God's Word. And everything that God has in this Word is Christ. That's who he is. He didn't just write it. I mean, he is this Word. That's why I say, whether it's in Revelation or Genesis, or in Deuteronomy or in Psalms, or in one of Paul's letters, or in one of James' epistles, it doesn't matter where he is, it's still Christ. He's still the one that's this Word. It's not just the Word of the men who put it down. He is the Word. And John signifies that. See, his name is the Word of God. So that tells us up front who's doing the trampling, who's doing the judging. No question about that. Now look at verses 14 through 16. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, that's righteousness, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. And he himself will rule with a rod of iron. He's got all the crowns on. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. Yep, he's carrying it out. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. These armies that's going to come, and the armies in heaven, clothed purity, meaning that there's no sin, right? They're pure, they're righteous. That's who they are. Well, who do you think that these armies are? And I'm just asking your opinion, and then I'm going to give you mine. Who do you think these armies are?
Babies.
Huh?
Babies.
Babies?
That have been adopted.
Why?
Herman Spraker. You know what I'm talking about?
Herman Spraker. Lord, I haven't heard of Herman
Spraker. He was talking about that.
That sounds like Herman.
Battles. He said, I believe that these armies of God will be the babies that have been killed and murdered.
Great, man. Well, old Herman. Anybody else who you think that they might be?
I don't know. I think we're down here, we're being trained ourselves. I think that we're being tried and tested, that we're being refined in the army of God.
We're being
trained as ambassadors now. We have a purpose here. I think that eventually that we will have a purpose up there, that we're just not living this life for no purpose at all.
Could be.
Those big battles, the martyrs.
What's that?
The martyrs. The people that's been martyred.
Let me hear Abby, and then I'll get whoever's saying martyrs. Are you saying martyrs? Yeah. Now, what did you say, Abby?
Best way to battle is through prayer.
Okay. And you said it could be the martyrs? Yeah. I tell you what we look at. Is a sense when the words say fine linen, you know, and it's white, and you automatically relate that to the saints because of the clothing, the white and clean and the fine linen. But that only indicates that there's no sin in these armies. They're pure. I think that they're angels. I think they're angels. Here's why I think they're angels. Turn to, you don't have to turn. Flip it over. I think I put Matthew 26 and 53 on the back. Look at Matthew chapter 26 and verse 53 on your reference sheet. Jesus said, and this is when they was arresting in the garden, and Peter pulled his sword out to cut the guy's ear off, and they were going to save him. Look what he says here. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels. Warrior angels. He said, you think I need you to save me? I can just tell the Father, and he'll send legions of angels. Here's why I think they're angels and not saints. I think, and I'll show you as we go through here, the new Jerusalem that we're going to see, that comes down out of heaven, we'll see that. I believe that is the Father's house that Jesus went to and said, in my Father's house are many mansions or many rooms. And if it's not true, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you so that where I am, there you may be also, which is, that's where he's going to end up, is in heaven. That's where he's going to be. But the new Jerusalem, David said, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And you can take that and say, well, that's language which symbolizes you're part of that family. Well, a word for house is house. So, I mean, I think the church is going to be in the new Jerusalem. I think that's where Christ went to prepare a place for us. And that's why I think that these armies are going to be angelic armies. You remember when, who was the prophet that was overtaken and the guy got scared and he said, we're getting ready to get beat up. Remember that? They're getting ready to kill us. And he said, no, if you will just look, there are angels that you can't see that are all around you. Remember that? And you remember that when he was in the garden, you know, when he prayed, the angels ministered. When he was in the wilderness, he was tempted, the angels ministered, didn't they? So I think it's the angels, it's the army will be who comes to carry out the battle that's going to be carried out. But it's not going to be a fight. You know, you picture loose is broke in the first 3.5 years. Remember, we saw the white horse that was turned loose and come out to do what? Make war upon the earth. And then, of course, death followed him and all this other stuff. So there are going to be battles the whole time. But this particular instance, Christ is coming with his army, and it ain't going to be no battle. He's coming to take over. He's coming to rule. He's not coming in to fight to see if he's going to win. He's going to win. He's just coming in to set up the kingdom that he's going to rule. So that's just what I think. It could be made up of angels and saints. Who knows? But there again, it's neither here nor there. The point is, he's coming to set that kingdom up that he said he would set up. Now, it says here in 15, now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron, for he himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. The rod of iron and the sharp sword. Sharp sword is the word of God. That is found in Ephesians 6 and 17. That's your answer. And then on your reference sheet, there's the scripture. Ephesians 6, 17. Take the helmet of salvation, Paul said, and the sword of the Spirit, capital S, which is the Word of God. So that's the sword that goes out of his mouth. So what does that tell you in regards to the fight? If the sword is the Word of God, remember, Paul said to the Corinthians, our weapons are not carnal in pulling down strongholds, but they are what? Mighty in God. Spiritual weapons, mighty in God. So all Christ is going to do is say, this is what's going to happen to you. It's already told right here. Here's the word. This is what's going to happen to you. And you're not going to have to wait and see. This is how it's going to happen. So it's the word of God that we're worrying about, because it's already went forth. But it goes forth out of his mouth so that it will be fulfilled with the word. So you know, it's not like he's going to say, you own the horse, be dead. You know, it's not that kind of thinking. It's a sense that they're going to fall because the word of God says they're going to fall. And the word of God says this is what's going to happen. And the word of God said this is going to be their outcome. And all he has to do is show up. And when he shows up, like it says he showed up, boom, the rest of it's happened. Huh? That's the way it goes. It's hard for us to put that together because we always think in terms of what the words actually say to us and how they mean to us. But if it was a battle, a literal battle that would be carried out and all this, and you know, like an actual. And I say all that because some people are under the delusion that it's going to be like a third world war, and then nuclear weapons are going to come. Listen, God's going to destroy this thing. I don't know how he's going to do it, what he'll do it with, but I know he's going to take care of it. Man is not going to bring an end to the world. God will. God has already said he's going to do it and how he's going to do it. So we just have to sit back and watch, because it's going to happen. Just exactly like he said, it's going to happen. So the word is the weapon, if you want to use weapon, because it is the sword of the Spirit. That's the only weapon it gives. He'll stomp them in his fierce wrath. He's treading the winepress. The blood spatters on his garment. He will break them into pieces with a rod of iron. I forgot to put that Psalm on there as a reference. Turn to Psalm chapter 2 and look at verse 9 really quick. And that's what that means. Psalm chapter 2 and verse 9. When you have to say amen. All right. Verse verse 9 of chapter 2, you shall break them with a rod of iron, you shall dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel. That's pretty tough language. You take an iron rod and hit a glass pot, or a clay pot. That's what's going to happen. That's what he's going to do. He's going to wipe out all the kingdoms and all the armies and everything that's set up now to try to rule and wants to run the world and control the world and the world's going to be here. Whack! And all that's gone. And he steps in to rule the world. Who was ruling the world prior to that in the first 7 years?
Satan.
Yeah, Satan and the Antichrist. Remember? He was running everything. And then the fall of Babylon happened. It all fell apart. Sure it did, because he steps in with that rod of iron and busts everything. Splinters, gone. Done away with it. Nothing they can do about it. The blood spatters on his garment. Because he has the right to do that. That's why it's repeated. He himself doesn't use the angels to do it. He himself brings that wrath. Doesn't use man to do it. He himself treads the winepress. And the wrath of who? Almighty God. You know, in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus made the statement, not my will, but yours be done, that wasn't just for the cross only. That wasn't just for the cross only. He's always done the will of the Father. That's what he was sent to do, and he will continue to do the will of the Father until that day that we are presented. He presents his church. His mission is completed when he presents the church unto God the Father, and they rule into eternity. And until that, he continues to do what the Father's will is. It's clear like that. It's the fact this is what God Almighty wants to do, and Christ is doing it, because that's the will of the Father to carry it out and to have it done. So he'll break them into pieces. And on his robe and on his side, there is a name written. It's actually a title, which is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, there's some discussion in big circles, which I didn't know, but Bernie McGee was in that circle. He was one of them, him and John Wolfert, who's the other commentator. I like him. He was the dean of theology at the Dallas Seminary. But there's big discussions within the academic part of the Bible as to whether or not that the name is actually written twice, or if it's the fact it was written on the robe. And they get that because it said, and he has on his robe and on his thigh, and they make a division as to that, because he's got on the robe, which is what? Dipped in blood. So it's a fact it's dipped in the blood. So would it be written twice? Would it be written on the robe and then on his thigh? Or is it just the fact he's got on the robe, it's the same one, and on his thigh, the one who's wearing the robe, is written King of Kings and Lord of Lords? As far as we're concerned, don't make no difference. It says on his robe and on his thigh, we're going to take it on his robe and on his thigh. And here's how it could be. On the robe would be like the priests, which wore on the breastplate of judgment, and I think I left that reference out because I didn't bold it. Turn to Exodus 28. I zoomed over that. Exodus 28. That comes up 27, right? Exodus 28 and verse 29. Actually, that whole chapter is about that, but I'm just going to look at this verse here. 28 and 29. Exodus. So Aaron shall bear the names of the sons of Israel on the breastplate. weight of judgment over his heart when he goes into the holy place as a memorial before the Lord continually. So those who come down on the side that it is written twice say that it is written on his robe because it goes back to this breastplate of judgment. And that's where this judgment is coming from, all those who have opposed the children of Israel. Could be. Now, the second one, which is the sword, or which is written upon his thigh, name is written King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the question being raised, well, why the thigh? Why would it be written on his thigh? Well, there again, if you go back, the swords that they used in their battles, a lot of times we picture the swords as the big long sword, you know, that we see on the TV and those big, you know, you see them in the big battles on the TV, they have those big, those things didn't come along until way after the Bible days. And it was towards an end in the Roman army. They used short, like, swords, which were big enough that they could get close to the person so they could aim it between the armor or into the throat or wherever they had to go with it. And these swords were strapped on their thighs. That they were kept on their thighs so they could get them. You know, like the gun guys put the holster on the side where you get a hold of it. Their swords were on the side. Well, how do we know that? Well, I'm glad you asked. Look on your reference, the Song of Solomon. Of all the books in the Bible, we would expect it, this love story to tell us about swords. But it does. In Song of Solomon, chapter 3 and verse 8, Shulamite says, they all hold swords, being expert in war. See, warriors. Every man has a sword. Where? On his thigh, because of fear in the night. So the thigh was significant in the sense of battle, in the sense of having to do with battle. Now take what we have just learned about the sword of the Spirit, right? And now on the thigh we have King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's the one that's going to get you. That's the one that's going to get you. You're not going to beat this guy. The enemies are not going to beat him. On his side, on his weaponry, where the weaponry is, it already says King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It ain't going to be that literal sword that's drawn out and done the battle. He's won it. He's riding in there on that charger to bring order to the earth as he said he was going to do. So, and I don't know that's why it's on the thigh. I don't know that. That's not the theological answer. We'll ask him. You know, he might tell us if he wants us to know. When we get there, we can say, by the way, what did this mean? You know, I saw, what is it? And he can explain it, but we really won't care then. It won't make no difference to us then. But that might be something to think about. Now, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords simply means what? You said many crowns meant that he was. So the King of Kings and Lord of Lords means ruling over all. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But we've got scripture to back that up too. 1 Timothy 6 and 15. On your sheet. I got that one on there. 1 Timothy 6 and 15 says, talking about Jesus, which he will manifest in his own time. There you go. He who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So the King of Kings and Lord of Lords is the potentate. What's a potentate? Potentate is a man who rules by force. A man who rules by force. See, they're not handing this thing over to Christ. He's taking it by force. He's trampling the winepress. He's going to use the sword out of his mouth, which is the word of God. He is forcefully doing this himself. So he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's going to rule through being the victor by overcoming. That's how he's going to establish the millennial kingdom. That's what's going to be set out. And we're going to get into some of that next week when we talk about the beast and his armies, which will be defeated. So we'll look at verses 17 through 21. We'll finish up the chapter next week and talk about how that takes place and how it happens. The Battle of Armageddon, which, as I said, ain't going to be much of a battle. But anywho, that's where we're headed. That's what the second coming of Christ on the earth is going to look like. The rapture is not the second coming. The rapture is the rapture. The second coming is when he comes at the end of the tribulation to set up this millennial kingdom. Questions or comments? Got her down pat. That's what I'm talking about. All right. Father, we thank you tonight. I thank you for these who go. I thank you that you're able to be here. I thank you for these who join us on Facebook and any and all who might look at this at some point. So, Lord, we just pray as we read this, and it's exciting language for the saved saints. For those of us who are born again, it's something for us to look forward to. But, Father, there are millions and millions out there who are not born again, and they're not ready to meet you. And this is not good language for them. It's not good to know that you would be a grape in a wine press that's going to get stomped, and your blood will fly upon the garment of the one stomping you. That's what the picture is. That's how violent it is, because God doesn't tolerate sin. That's why Jesus died for it on the cross and shed his blood, that we could be forgiven of it. So everybody that refuses that forgiveness will suffer this wrath of God. It will happen to them. So I just pray that nobody that we know will have to endure that. Nobody we know will go through that. But that everybody that we know will come in contact with, that they will know you. Because we have shared you with them. We have told them about you. And I pray that they will just listen. So thank you for these that listen intently. And thank you for the work they do out there in the field and the way they teach others about this and answer questions for them. Thank you for using them to do that, because that's what disciples do. And we'll give you all the thanks and the praise and the glory for it all. In your name, Jesus, I say it by faith. And all the saints would say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you guys for tuning in.